In the annals of this country, Lionel Frank Sukaran was a dynamic politician, a highly skilled debater, and a nationalist who contributed significantly to the advent of the 1962 Independence Constitution of Trinidad and Tobago. To Diane Sukaran, her brother and four sisters, Lionel Sukaran was the best father in the world.
A father that every child should have, ought to have, and dreams of. That is the kind of father he was. An extraordinary man whose love, coupled with discipline, was evident in the creation and who believed in of the mindset of his children. And it was a balance, a mix, a judicious mix between the two. A really fantastic father that in your later lives, this is when you appreciate him.
Lionel Sukaran spent most of his early childhood in the South Trinidad village of Tableland, at a time when the villagers had neither pipe-borne water nor electricity. A Brahmin, Sukaran was drilled from the cradle to become a pundit, coming as he did from a deeply rooted Hindu family, orthodox in every sense of the word. When he first attended school at the Tableland EC, making the long journey on foot through mud tracks, he was barefooted, dressed in a dhoti, and could not speak a word of English. Even his name was different. He was known as Lakshmi Prasad Sharma. After pleading with his grandfather, the dominant figure in this strict Brahmin household, and after he had shown himself to be fluent in Hindi and Sanskrit, young Sharma was allowed to grow his hair, wear a pair of shoes, and replace his dhoti with a shirt and pants. As he himself would later recall, he was put in a shirt and pants and made an Englishman in the Caribbean. And indeed, before long, he was speaking like one, earning in later years a distinction in English in his first pupil teacher examination. But what his grandfather feared most was that his precocious grandson, who was now a pundit, would, like his eldest son, renounce Hinduism and embrace Christianity. He feared that his grandson would become contaminated by their nearest neighbor, Joseph Dindyal, a Presbyterian. So he took the youngster out of school and sent him to become a tailor. It was in the course of pursuing his trade that Sharma would meet his future wife, Ruth, who, as fate would have it, was the daughter of the feared Presbyterian Joseph Dindyal. Ruth eventually persuaded the young Pandit Sharma to return to school and was instrumental in his success at obtaining a position as a pupil teacher at a Presbyterian school in the area. After 3 months of teaching, young Sharma felt it was time to spread his wings and become an accredited teacher. But his path was blocked. He was told that the only way he could become an accredited teacher was by converting to Christianity. With his love of teaching and conscious of the many indignities he suffered as a Hindu, the young Sharma took a drastic, life-changing decision. He decided to get baptized in the Christian faith. In the blink of an eye, Pandit Lakshmi Prasad Sharma became Lionel Frank Sukaran. But not only would he embrace Christianity, the newly christened Lionel Sukaran would later go on to marry Ruth Dindyal, who was already deeply rooted in Presbyterianism. To understand his transition from Hinduism, which he never completely discarded, to Christianity, is to appreciate the fact that Lionel Sukaran was a unique human being. And so too was his wife Ruth, who would become the mother of their five children.
Her qualities, her essence, was soft, caring, loving, excellent wife with a great mind. And it tempered in their private lives his capitalistic nature, so that it added to the dimension that was him. She was his greatest critic. He made no speeches unless she had vetted what he was about to say. He practiced in front of her from the time when they were young people at school together, coming forward. This was a habit between them. They made no business decisions that were not fully discussed. Their children were grown. The home was run on a joint basis, so that their business interests, their political interests, and their family life was a total partnership.
Of course, Sukaran's marriage to Ruth Dindyal came after he was admitted to the Naparima Training College to be trained as a teacher, and after he had returned in triumph to teach at the school that had first rejected him.
She was the daughter of, in those days, what was termed the catechist in the church, and came from a very deep Christian background. And he, of course, came he was a Brahmin Hindu from the very deep Brahmanic track, first generation Indian. So that you can imagine the strength of the root there. So in order to marry her, she was very clear. She was not going to marry him unless, one, he agreed with her belief. He could hold his own, but he had to understand hers. And secondly, he had to have a future. And in order to have a future, for a young man coming from the countryside, it had to be something that was in line with what was being allowed. And so teaching was the obvious path forward. He could not become a teacher unless, of course, he was a Christian. And so this is how he becomes baptized. And as he says, you sprinkle a few drops of water on my head, and the pundit becomes the Christian.
Now determined to widen his political horizons, Lionel Sukaran was elected to the San Fernando Borough Council, where his wife Ruth was also a councillor. He served on the Borough Council from 1946 to 1955, almost simultaneously with his tenure as President General of the All Trinidad Sugar Estates and Factory Workers Trade Union. He would also become Secretary of the Ratepayers Association, a leading member of the Literary and Agricultural Societies, and co-editor of the Indian Sentinel newspaper. The ambitious Lionel Sukaran eventually went on to study law at the Middle Temple Inn in London. But before completing his finals, he returned home to contest the 1950 general elections. He was defeated in those elections by Attorney at Law Ashford Sinanan, another political stalwart from South Trinidad. Then came the 1956 general elections, and Sukaran won as an independent candidate. He went into the Legislative Council and served there for 10 crucial years. Lionel Sukaran was already well known as a skillful debater, having, since in the 1920s, won the coveted Ghani McCartney Cup, which was then a symbol of debating supremacy. He was also on record as winning prizes for the best orator, upstaging such luminaries as Dr. Winston Mahabir and Indian diplomat Indar Bahadur Singh. So it was to be expected that the eloquent Lionel Sukaran, who once could not speak a word of English, would make the legislature his stage. His name soon became a household word as the finest debater in Parliament. But it was in the Sukaran household that his debating skills came under the strictest scrutiny.
You always sat down at dinner time together around the table. And the conversation was of what was going on in the country, as well as of philosophy. A great deal of philosophy was discussed around the table. So that in the course of the conversation, the tie-in between philosophy and what was ongoing within the country sort of came together during the table. So from a very young age, you have that going on. And our parents were discussing with my elder brothers and sisters and ourselves as children, even having a voice in there, whatever was moot at the time and going on. So that you were required to make an input. You had to, that was his demand, that you had to make a contribution to what was going on at the table. So whatever the conversation, you had it here. And so he would be speaking about what the stance he was taking on different issues. And you were allowed to make an input there. So that if you didn't agree with him, you had to stand up and defend what he was saying. He had to say, why was he doing this? And you were allowed to make an input as to why you thought he shouldn't be doing this, and you had to found your arguments in something that was sound.
Ms. Sukaran attributes her father's debating skills to his tremendous mental acuity, his almost photographic memory, and his capacity for research. She says this capacity for research was something he had in common with the late Prime Minister, Dr. Eric Williams, who might have been a foe in Parliament, but a friend elsewhere.
Because he had travelled the route from the deep countryside into the urban sector, fought the battles of the societal framework in which we operated at the point of time, was an aristocrat and an autocrat, but coming from the deep society, understanding the rural community, there was a great commonality in the focus and the vision between the two men. The difference was in how you would implement in the final analysis. The policy decisions were very close. There was an understanding, however, on Daddy's part, that Dr. Williams had invited him to join the party. But he understood very clearly that you could not from the inside make the kind of contribution that you could from the outside. This was not a man who tolerated any dissent within his party rank. And I think that Daddy understood that clearly, so he never joined the PNM. So there was the sharing of the whole research and philosophical research that went on inside of there between the two of them. But it was founded in a basis of respect, Daddy for Williams and Williams for Daddy's independence and for his deep nationalism. I think that is, and in it was a great friendship.
Just one decade after her father's death in December 1992, Diane Sukaran would herself become a parliamentarian, having been elected as the PNM representative for San Fernando West in the 2002 general elections. She says the era of politicians like Dr. Williams and Lionel Sukaran was an era when the government and opposition parties, though occupying different ethnic domains, both shared the same aspirations. The objectives of both sides of the house were the same, although the means towards those objectives may have been different.
So that the government of the day wanted to do certain things. Williams' bent was very much to empower his people, move them out of the chains of bondage that had been imposed upon them by a colonial style of thinking, educate them, all of these things. So there was a commonality of purpose and of developing a society that was upward moving and mobile, a place for all people, etc. So there was a focus in that of developing the correct kind of institutional framework under which the people of Trinidad and Tobago could operate so as to achieve all of the things that all the people wanted to achieve. And so there's that common vision.
In 1959, Lionel Sukaran, a strong advocate of national independence, was included in a team that went to London to discuss constitutional reform with the colonial government there. Discussions that would lead to the independence of Trinidad and Tobago in August 1962. He would later join the ranks of the then opposition Democratic Labour Party. Asked about the legacy Lionel Sukaran may have left his children and his country, this is what daughter Diane had to say.
It's the greatest gift, I think, is that we are door openers, that we open the doors, all his children, for people to use the asset base that we have, the opportunities, the contact levels that we have, to help other people achieve what is their fullness and the love of country that comes before all things.
And about the legacy he left to the country he loved.
The government of the day, the People's National Movement at the time, Dr. Williams, wanted to implement a constitution that was wanted by the government. The opposition added to that debate in Trinidad and in Marlborough House. And between them, they hammered out, with the arbitration panel being the British government, hammered out a constitution that has given us the fundamental freedoms and rights that we have today. Rights that ensure equality between all the citizens of our very, very multicultural society. And I think that is a very tremendous gift that not only Daddy, but all the people of that generation gave to us.
Lionel Frank Sukaran died on December 15, 1992, marking the end of a colorful chapter in the political history of Trinidad and Tobago.